Today we are driving to the Scotland of India.
I've never encountered a jeera dosa before.
We're now entering the national park. Welcome to Coorg. The next couple of days we're going to be driving around Coorg, exploring interesting places where you can stop for a great meal.
This isn't just a restaurant, it's almost like a museum.
Thick chunks of bacon. That's the sort of heady flavor and aroma that I'm tasting in this.
So we checked into this hotel after a rather indulgent lunch.
The bambale, it's combined rather well with the slightly fatty juices of that mutton keema.
Hi folks, welcome to another drive vlog, and today we are driving to the Scotland of India. For those of you who've not got it, well, we're driving to Coorg here in the southern west part of Karnataka. So one of the requests that I've been receiving on and off is for us to look at places to dine at when in Coorg. So Coorg is a popular destination, a popular getaway here from Bengaluru. And when people go to Coorg, there's not much that is available, at least online, in terms of places that you can dine at. So I think what typically happens is that people usually go to the resorts, homestays, etc. for 2 or 3 days, and they spend most of their time there. So therefore, there's not too much exploration that happens outside, especially when it comes to dining. And so what we've decided is the next couple of days, we're going to be driving around Coorg, exploring interesting places where you can stop for a great meal. So we've just entered the Mysuru Expressway. So the route for today will be Mysuru Expressway and then turn right towards Hunsur, and then we will enter Coorg towards the Gonikappal side, and tomorrow we will make our way to Madikeri from there. So by the end of this, we should have unearthed some interesting dining spots for you to savor. So stick around till the end of this vlog. I'm looking forward to this and I hope you find this interesting too. It's a beautiful morning here on the expressway. Great weather, it's not raining, but quite overcast. I've said this in my last vlog as well, but I think this expressway has made connectivity so much easy. Even the last time around when we drove to Mangalore via Sampajay Ghat. In fact, you must take a look at that vlog. I'm going to place links in the description below. We could only attempt that route. It's a much longer route because of the expressway. Speaking of the expressway, I've been getting comments that this is an access-controlled highway. Well, whatever it is, it certainly has made connectivity a lot easier. So typically, the route that goes via Sampeche is about 430 or 440 odd kilometers. In the old Mysuru route, it would have taken us about 10 hours. But because of this road, we could do it, I think, in just over 8 hours or so, 8 and a half hours. So you must take a look at that vlog, because we've also explored some interesting stops along the way, like we will in this vlog as well. Madikeri is 209 kilometers, Mysuru 104. You literally have clouds that are resting atop that mountain top. Over the last few weeks or months, I've been driving a lot. Of course, the fact that some of you also commented that it's because of Jimny that we're doing all these drives. Yes, you're not wrong at all. But you're appreciating nature so much more as you drive through lush fields, gaze at the horizon in the distance. And I think in a state like Karnataka, there's so much that you can actually explore. Whether it's coffee country, the beaches, the Western Ghats. And I guess that's also the reason why we are seeing so many more people on the road, especially post the pandemic. I think everybody just wants to get out. And when you've got roads like these, well, it makes driving quite relaxing. I'm on cruise control. My speedo is at 90 and I'm just coasting along. I'm in no hurry to get to where I want to go. Of course, we have a schedule, we have an itinerary over the next couple of days, but I want to take it easy. I want to coast along. I want to enjoy this journey. I want to enjoy the experience of getting there. I think many a times we focus so much on the destination that we want to get there in a hurry. I think we're crossing Ramnagar because I can see these mountain peaks, these granite mountain peaks. So the rains have also helped the greenery, also the bursts of yellow from the flowers. So our first stop this morning is Hunsur, and we're roughly about 120 odd kilometers from there. I've heard of this very old eatery. I'm told it's about 60-65 years old. They do a nice tiffin thindi. Slightly off the highway, the state highway, but those in the know stop there. So that's our first halt on this, what I'm hoping will be an epic Coorg food tour. They have these speed cameras now that they've installed, speed meters that tell you how fast you're going. I think the next step for them will be to track it, perhaps remotely, and as you exit the tollway or at some point along the way, they're going to pull you over and fine you if you're over speeding. Nothing wrong in that. It's about making these roads safer for all of us collectively. I think this is my fourth or fifth time on the expressway. I must say that the number of, let's say, rash drivers, I haven't seen too many this morning. Maybe I saw one or two, but otherwise everybody's coasting along on the center lane at 80, 90, and that's the way it should be, right? You are chilled out and you're relaxed, and even people around you are relaxed. We're just crossing Shivalli on the right hand side. That's the other thing that has happened with this highway. Many of the old places that were just off the highway are now hidden from us. You have to make an effort to actually look for the exit and find your way to those places. We're not used to that, right? Usually you'll have places just along the highway, so you see something and you just stop. But now you can do that. You've got to plan it. But I think it also makes it safer. On this expressway, you've got to be careful as you approach the bridges because suddenly the lanes converge and become narrow. So if you're not paying attention, it could catch you by surprise. So I've got a drive log on the expressway. So you must take a look at it if you haven't caught it yet. We're now on our way towards Srirangapatna, 78 kilometers to Hunsur. Exiting the expressway now, 121 kilometers and 2 hours of driving. Murphy's Law. When you want a smooth exit, you will be stuck behind the car that has no fast tag. Minor gripes on our way to Hunsur. I think I'm getting hungry. Bringing out the crankiness in me. So the total drive distance on this two-day trip will be roughly around 600 kilometers or so. So when you talk about places in Coorg, there's Virajpet, which is the southern part of Coorg, and then there's Madikeri, which is also the administrative center for Coorg district, which is in the center, and then there is Somwarpet, which is the northern part of Coorg. So what we've done is we've identified some restaurants across the district. So we're going to make a beginning, of course, Hunsur. Hunsur is not Coorg, it's much before you enter Coorg, but we had to do breakfast somewhere. And then the first point where we enter Coorg, or the first point where we stop after entering Coorg, will be Gonikopal. And that's where we are doing two or three places. And then from there on, tomorrow we'll find our way to Virajpet. So all in all, I think we'll cover about 200 odd kilometers in Coorg. Not the entire district per se, because it's a vast district. It's about 4,000 square kilometers. I was quite shocked when I learned of it. Because typically what happens is when we go to Coorg, we go to a resort or we go to a place where we stay and that's it. We don't really explore the rest of it. But Coorg is a very big district and stretches right from the north to the south. So this visit will cover about 200 kilometers and savor hopefully interesting meals about 6 or 7 places along the way. This stretch from where you turn off right at Mysuru Ring Road going towards Madikeri, the first part of it, especially till Hunsur, is a bit of a struggle. Two narrow lanes and a lot of traffic. Some mild showers as we make our way to Hunsur. So this weekend I went with my motorcycling buddies to Kotigayara, and the rains that greeted us there was at a different level altogether. So you must look out for that drive log too of making our way to Kotigayara, which is just before Charmadi. I'm told this year it is also one of the highest rainfall receiving areas in Karnataka. Usually it's Agumbe. And speaking of Agumbe, I have a drive log on Agumbe too that you would have seen on the channel already, I suppose, before this. So a lot of exciting drive logs coming up on this second channel. And I hope you've subscribed to this channel, the Kripalamana Vlogs channel. Food Lovers TV is all about food, but the Kripalamana Vlog channel is also about experiences like these. Just rained a brief bit there, and now the sun is out, shining down on us through the clouds. We're in Hunsur. This seems to be a very old-fashioned sort of a place, so I'm not expecting much by way of the facilities. So if that is important to you as a traveler, then perhaps you should stop somewhere else also and then get the Tiffin Tindia. And I did see a couple of places on this route which seem to be large restaurants. Like they say, you can't have it all, right? So if you want great food, well, they may not have the restrooms. And if you have the restrooms, well, the food may be okay. Because earlier when you drove to Coorg, there were not too many places that you could stop at once you got past Mysuru. But things have obviously changed since. We found the place, but we're trying to figure out where to park. So that could be a challenge when you come here, when you get here. Illi park madboda? Namaskara.
Namaste.
So eshtu helithiru idu?
Idanu 67 years.
67 years.
Old hotel.
Well, we've got two dosas here. So one is, of course, the dosa that I've heard about, which is the set masale dosa. So, which is made with the butter, I'm told, and there's some palya within. Just a little bit of a smear of the palya, not too much. And then, of course, we have something called the jeera dosa. Now, this I've never eaten before. And it's always nice to come to a 67-year-old place and find something that you haven't tasted before. You know I love my dosa, but I've never encountered a jeeri ke dosa, a jeera dosa before. This is the jeera set dosa here at Hotel Shabri Prasad. This is a dosa that goes crunch from the first bite to the last. This is a dosa that is crunchy yet soft. You can definitely taste the butter, but it's not the sort that is dripping out of the dosa. It's got enough butter that is held within the pores of the dosa, contributing to its crunchy yet soft bite. This is a dosa that certainly has a bit of strength.
Tumma taste it, sir.
There's loads of cumin here. So all that I'm tasting on my palate now is the flavor of cumin, the flavor of roasted cumin. If you're catching it on Kripalamana Vlogs, well, you'll only catch an excerpt of this outing here to Shabri Prasad. For the full episode, definitely look it up on Gourmet on the Road, Food Lovers TV. Madikeri, you go straight 68 kilometers, and Virajpet, you take a left 50 kilometers, and that's where we are going since we're going towards Gonikopa. So that was a good breakfast at Hotel Shabari Prasad. Of course, the place is quite modest. It's a Hale Kala the Jaga, meaning an old world sort of a place. So the vibe, the ambience, the service, and all of it is like that. But the dosa certainly are quite interesting. In fact, they also have some food trucks here that people normally stop at. So I'm glad that we made our first stop at Hotel Shabari Prasad. So definitely something to taste. That set jeere ke dosa was quite interesting. Something that I hadn't tasted before. And if you haven't tasted it yet, definitely try it out. So now we are on our way to a restaurant that I've heard good things about. This is an eatery called Cuisine Papera, and they do Kodwa food, authentic Kodwa food, and even the space is quite interesting. Looking forward to lunch there. Nice stretch of road that leads up to Virajpet. When I took the Madikeri route the last time around, I remember it being a lot busier. I suppose also because that's the district headquarters, perhaps there's more traffic going there. Whereas here there's not too much traffic that we've passed. Nice fields on either side. I'm told ginger is very popularly grown here, and also tobacco. I can also spot some areca plantations in the distance there. So this route also after Virajpet goes into Kerala. And when we visited Kannur, when we rode to Kannur last year, this is the route that we took. Quite a peaceful drive here to Virajpet. I guess most of the activity is on the Madikeri route perhaps. And also to get to North Coorg, you have to go through Madikeri. And then of course also a route into Mangalore. A very interesting drive to Mangaluru. Not the usual Shiradi or Charmadi that one is so used to taking. And actually that's what also got me thinking about doing this drive through Coorg, because I stopped at Coorg Cuisine in Madikeri, and that's where we had lunch. And you will see an episode on Coorg Cuisine as well, an eatery in Coorg that serves authentic home style Kodwa fare. And as I was tasting the food there, that also led me to think that I should explore more food in Coorg. So what we're trying to do this trip is we've tried to pick different restaurants where every restaurant is not going to be about only traditional Kodwa food. We've tried to pick restaurants that are also doing some things a little different, just so that everything doesn't end up becoming another pandi curry, right? We love a pandi curry, but you don't want every episode to be only about the pandi curry. I'm sure there's going to be plenty of pork that we will taste here in Coorg, because after all, out here they love their pandi, be it in the form of a curry or a bartadu. We will taste that, of course, but we will also taste some other things. The one thing that people don't realize is that Coorg also has a lot of vegetarian food. This is produce that is foraged in certain seasons. So whether it's things like the forest mango or bamboo, they also use ferns, the fiddlehead ferns that go into cooking here. There's a lot of importance that's given to produce in this part of the state. So I'm hoping that we'll also get to taste some of that. We are 33 minutes, 23 kilometers from Gonikopa. Some tobacco that's finding its way, I guess, to the tobacco factory. We all know of the ills of tobacco, but I guess for the farmers out here, it's their livelihood. It's not all black and white, right? Life, more than the black or the white, there are many shades of grey. We're now entering the national park, the Rajiv Gandhi National Park. Some pomegranate and ginger. There's somebody selling dragon fruit and ginger back there. We're entering the park now. Zero tolerance zone. Nagarhole Tiger Reserve. Wow. Well, the sign says elephant crossing. I hope we spot an elephant or two here in Nagarhole. I've got a 360 camera on top recording. We can't stop anywhere in the forest when you're driving, so I hope that camera doesn't fall off or fly off. That fresh forest air. So there was a sign back there that said, please don't feed the animals. It will change their natural habits. That's so important to remember, to realize that. The animals, the monkeys especially, because that's what I see people feeding, have all that they need in the forest. But because they are fed on the road, it's changing their habit. So perhaps instead of going up into the trees, they come to the roads now, which is highly unsafe for them. So when we feed animals and we think that we're doing a kind, good deed, not really. You're actually endangering the life of the animals. So please don't feed the animals, whether you see them in a forest, whether you see them on a ghat somewhere. There's enough that they have in what nature provides. It's been a long time since I've done one of these jungle trails. I think the last time was somewhere in Kabini, I think. We come from the city. Just seeing this green, forget the animals, seeing this green itself is so thrilling. We're out of the forest now, and now we can stop and hopefully we've got some interesting footage. The Tata Coffee Estate on our right hand side. Welcome to Coorg. Well, that's where we are now. We're already in Coorg. We've been greeted by the rains as soon as we entered Coorg. Driving through coffee country now, which also brings us close to Gonikoppa. We're about 10 minutes away now, 8 kilometers. The location of our next stop in this culinary journey. We're stopping at a restaurant called Cuisine Papera that I'm told showcases the culinary traditions of Coorg. Looking forward to this meal. Beautiful weather. This is amazing. Amazing to drive on this route towards Virajpet.
Hello.
This is Rajesh.
Even before you reach the restaurant, you get a sense of the heritage of the Kodavas. This isn't just a restaurant, it's almost like a museum.
More like a museum. We will be preparing Adivasi pork now.
I love the sound that the fat is making as it's being grilled and dripping its juices onto the pieces of meat. Finally, neer bharta hai there.
Taste na.
I can taste the smoky bite of the meat. There's a fair bit of the sourness, no? That comes from the kachampuli and the kai puli. And that hit of the
bird
spice,
eye chili.
The bird eye chili.
Chili.
You can feel the heat of the kandari chili. I can hear my voice now. Vanakarchi. My mouth is owned by the smoky flavor of the pork. You can see the bits of the pork there that are charred. You can see each strand of the pork there. All moisture has left that piece of meat.
So the closest I can describe it is thick chunks of bacon. That's the sort of heady flavor and aroma that I'm tasting in this. I love the concept of this baimbale. The fact that earlier they would cook the baimbale in the pork fat. But of course here we have the luxury of the baimbale being cooked alongside the pork and being served with the pork, not just the fat.
It's a pork catchy drink.
This is like in Kerala what they call touchings, no?
Usually after a good meal, gravy of the mango curry, toss it in the curd and keep on sucking the juice and the curd along.
Well, that was a big lunch here at Cuisine Papera. I can feel myself groaning under the weight of all the dishes that I tasted. So if you want to watch the complete episode, you will find it on Food Lovers TV. What I showcased here was just an excerpt, was just a preview of an amazing lunch that I had. You know, many a times when I go to places like these, it's not just about showcasing what they do, but for me also, it's about understanding something new. When we talk about Coorg cuisine, or when you look at Coorg food that's available outside, it's usually centered around the pandi curry and little else. But there was so much variety that I saw in the menu here that we spent over 2.5 hours of footage time filming at Cuisine Papera. Gives you an idea of all that we would have tasted and experienced. So that was lunch. As for the rest of our plan here at Gonikopal, we've arrived here at a hotel called the Cocoon. It's a small little hotel in the heart of Gonikopal town. We've selected this for two reasons. One, there's a restaurant here that we will explore in the evening. And right next door is also our breakfast stop for tomorrow. And we just stumbled upon this balcony where you get a bird's eye view of Gonikopal. You can see the bustle of the street below. And in the distance, you can see the mountains and some of the coffee estates that fringe this town in South Coorg. So we checked into this hotel in the afternoon, actually late afternoon, after a rather indulgent lunch comprising mostly of Kodava delicacies. So therefore, I'm looking forward to tasting something a little different.
So this place is actually my husband's brainchild. He quit his job, he came back to Coorg, started this restaurant where the locals can come.
With the mint chutney, I think it works well. The flavor certainly hit home on this. Hits the spot should you find yourself here on a monsoony Gonikopal evening. Well, we've quickly switched tracks from the multi-cuisine side of things here, from that chicken malai tikka to the chicken manchurian to something that certainly looks a lot more appealing even as it found its way to the table. So what I have here is a baimbale keema. So the baimbale is a fresh bamboo and it's in season just this point in time. I think that's an interesting thing about the produce here. Most of it is very seasonal and it depends on what's available. And I think that's a great way of cooking things. And then we also have a chicken curry here. The combination for the baimbale is the akkioti and for the chicken curry, I'm told, is the nool puttu. And since it's a multi-cuisine restaurant, we also have some kadai mutton. The baimbale, it's combined rather well with the slightly fatty juices of that mutton keema. The flavor of this chicken curry is also the sort that you'll perhaps find in a home out here in Gonikopal. Lush and creamy. There's also a slight hint of bitterness from the avocado. And that's where that garnish of some raisin comes handy, just to lend the avocado a bit of its sweetness to offset the bitterness. Now for some of that mango. Feels very homely. We're just getting ready for our day here in Coorg. Slightly delayed start because our hotel here didn't seem to have hot water. So that was a bit of an adventure in the morning, but it's nice to have some excitement in your life every once in a while.
So today the plan here for our gourmet drive in Coorg is breakfast is right next door, which is the reason why we picked this particular hotel to stay in. Dinner last night was an interesting affair. A bit of a mixed bag, but I'm glad we got to taste some dishes that were interesting and perhaps are the restaurant's strength. I think that's the challenge whenever you go into a multi-cuisine restaurant. You need to be lucky enough to pick the right dishes, and I'm glad that we did manage to spot those dishes perhaps a little midway into our meal. So breakfast is going to be at this restaurant called Classic, and after that we will drive to Madikeri. We have one or two spots in our mind. For the complete episodes of this tasting, definitely look up Food Lovers TV, Gourmet on the Road, because that's where you'll find it. Out here, you'll just find a bit of a preview, a bit of a teaser if you like. So stick around with us. Today's going to be an interesting day as well.